The whole backstage is going to be open there, and then we're going to have a great show next.
Don't listen to air, Jack.
Okay. Relax, everybody. Enjoy yourself, and laugh if you find it funny. Laugh even if you don't find it funny.
Don't
we need
tell
your help.
Me I can't come in to find a seat. What's the matter with you?
No one is allowed in the studio once the show starts, especially.
Get your unmanicured hands off my poochie! She's just a nervous wreck. That's the reason why I'm late. I had to wait for my little baby to go toy. Come on, honey, let's find a seat. Michael Pressman! Kids are people too! Michael, how are you? Michael Pressman's in the audience! That's fantastic! Marlene! How are you? I didn't know you were going to be here tonight! Oh, the lift looks marvelous, dear! Just marvelous! Yes, I'll call you later! Is that seat saved? Can I sit there? Oh, well, thank you! Aren't you a sweet one? Thank you very much. That was Marlene. You know Marlene? Yes. She's one of my oldest friends. In fact, she is my oldest friend. 55 if she's a day. And did you see that lift? Well, the doctor must have used a crane to hoist it up. Oh, by the way, dear, don't ever wear this color again. It doesn't suit your complexion.
Shh. Oh, shut up!
Live from the home of the world champion Los Angeles Lakers, this is Friday! Starring Mark Langfield, Mary Edith Burrell, Melanie Chartoff, Larry David, Darryl Igus, Prentice Kemp, Bruce Mahler, Michael Richards, John Ross, and special guest star, Bozstan. And I'm Jack Byrne. Now, speaking on behalf of the entire cast, here is Melanie Chartoff.
Thank you, and good evening. Thank you. And now I would like to perform my personal rendition of Stephen Foster's The Swanee River. Mr. Moffat, I haven't completed the bridges yet.
Melanie.
I'm sorry. And now, the first sketch.
And all I say to you, that only through free and open debate can the primary process be a truly meaningful one. I am ready now, as I have been throughout this campaign, to debate the issues. I stand before you today, not as a presidential candidate, but as a citizen who shares your profound concerns over the direction and leadership of this country. You, the students of Hollywood High School, are the leaders of tomorrow. The standard bearers of a new frontier. So in conclusion, let me say to you, in the words of Elvis Costello, oh, Allison, Allison, I know this world is killing you. Oh, Allison, Allison, my aim is true.
Stern's here.
Yeah, fine. Fine. Okay, fine. Send them out. Yeah. Did you have a chance to go through that speech yet?
Yes, and I have a few questions about it.
They're really going to have to wait. You have an important meeting now in just a few moments.
Well, there are still several references I don't understand. First of all, who or what is Meatloaf?
Look, Ted, we can go over all this in the car, but right now you're going to have to take a long, hard look at your California campaign. Now, I've called up a special consultant team. They're on their way up right now.
Oh, Rick, I still say we should be using our own people here in California. This primary is too damn important to trust to outside consultants.
Ted, we have no choice. With Carter refusing to debate, we're going to have a solid strategy that will guarantee us a victory in California, or we are through. These people have the best track record of any political consultant in California. We need a victory, Ted. They can give it to us.
I understand that. Still feel a lot better if one of them were married to my sister.
Okay, that's them now.
Open it up.
Ready?
Go ahead.
Welcome. How do you do? Please come in. Senator, this is the California Advance Team.
Hey! I remember this room. This is where Bowie stayed on his Diamond Dogs tour. Yeah!
Senator Manny Roth, International Political Management.
Mr. Roth?
We've met before, Senator. I used to handle Peter Lawford.
Of course.
Let me introduce you to the team. This is Debbie Slash.
Hey.
Miss Slash?
I got Johnny Rotten's endorsement in the bag. If you win, he wants to be Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare.
And this is Hadji Chimnoy. Hadji, here's our chief fundraiser.
Mr. Chimnoy.
I have great relations with the fat cats. In one of my previous lives, I was a cat.
meow, Mr. Chimoy.
Okay, we're here to win a primary. Let's get down to business.
Well, I was reading that speech you sent over, and I don't know, it doesn't feel right to me. I can't quite... There are several questions I have about it.
Heh, questions. That's what I love about this guy. Always with the questions, eh?
Yeah.
Okay, first of all, the look is all wrong. Give him the jacket.
Yeah.
Jacket? What are you talking about? Hey, what's going on here?
Get
hey,
it.
Wait a minute. This isn't very Ivy League. I don't...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the hair. We got to do something about that hair.
Well, this hair has served my family well for many years.
I've been going over some of the speeches here. I've rewritten them a little bit.
Well, that's what I wanted to talk to you about. I don't quite see what...
Just take a look at it. You know, go over it. Get the feel of it.
Well, all right. And I say to you today that the issues which are of concern to the people of California are the economic issues.
Come on, let's see some of that Kennedy charisma.
Yeah, come on.
I say to you that it is getting to the point where an average family cannot afford to keep up two Mercedes. I say to you that the hot tub industry is in its biggest slump in years. I say to you that you cannot get a decent gram of cocaine for less than $150. I can't say these things.
You want to win, don't you?
Well, of course, but
all right, trust me, this is California. All right, now let's try it again. And this time, you know, put some energy into
yeah.
it.
Energy?
Get your body into
my
it.
My body into
yes.
it?
Yeah, yeah, let's see some moves, you know? Come on.
Come on.
And furthermore, I would favor an agricultural policy which offers price supports to the growers of California marijuana. The price of homegrown has risen to nearly $200 a lid.
All right.
It's time to bring down the cost of domestic weed. I don't care how much trouble I'm in. This is not the Kennedy style of campaigning.
Senator, will you excuse us a moment, please?
Of course. I'll check this stuff out with Joan.
This is pretty grim.
He's so stiff.
Well, what do you think?
We've got a serious image problem here.
I can't understand it. 6 months ago, he was a shoe-in.
Look, what can I tell you? You know, in this business, when you're hot, you're hot.
Yeah.
Isn't there anything you can do?
Give it our best shot.
All right, that's all I have.
Jones behind me 100%.
Listen, you just keep working on getting that energy level up, and don't worry about a thing. We got this one in the bag. If he wins this, I'll book him on That's Incredible.
Rick, I heard what he said. He's right. We can never win this. I haven't got a prayer. Camelot's over with. The 60s are over with. We don't have the support of the young people.
Ted, buck up. Listen, Nixon lost California. 4 years later, he was president.
Rick, you may have something there. Bring the car around. I'm going to work on a new speech. The people of California have made their decision. You won't have Ted Kennedy to kick around anymore. I'll be back. By God, I'll be back.
A new swear word sweeps America. Details on the Friday edition coming up shortly.
Go on in here, Bill. Hey, Bob.
Chuck. How you doing, Jerry? Now, listen, I'd like you guys to meet a friend of mine. Bill. Why don't you meet these guys? Yeah, he's just starting out.
Hi.
How you doing, Dave? Hey, Dave. You know how to get rid of 10 pounds ugly fat?
Cut off your head.
What'd you say? Well, you heard me. Huh? Great bunch of guys, huh? Yeah, they're all my friends. They've been to my house. Hey, no smoking. You better put that out, Bill.
Look, I don't know, Dick. Maybe this isn't for me. Maybe I'm just the jogging and tennis type.
You hey, know? You want to be V-shaped, don't you? We're all V-shaped here.
Well, I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'll go through my workout, and then when you see how beefy and puffy and shiny I get, maybe you'll change your mind. Right?
I don't know.
All right. What I like to do is just warm up a little bit. I'm feeling pretty good now. Go ahead, kick me in the groin. Go on. I can take it. Do it. Go on.
Why would I want to do that?
Well, suit yourself. Well, I'd like to go over the mirror now and check out the torso, see what parts need special attention. How you doing, Vince? Oh, yeah. You know, you're looking pretty big, fella. But, you know, I was watching you when you were bench pressing. You shouldn't scrunch your face up so much. Makes you look babyish. Oh, yeah. Don't have to worry about the legs. They're obviously in top condition. Chest looks pretty good. Well, I see all that work I've been doing on the neck has really paid off. Yeah, big neck. Makes your head look small. I like that. Arms look good, too. Well, I think I'll get in a little bench pressing. I'll see you later, Vince. Yeah. You're all right. You want to get that supporter for me over there against the wall? Come on, hustle it up. Let's go.
What is this thing for?
Well, Bill, I don't want to hurt myself, you know. Yeah, I wouldn't be much good to the girls then, would I? I get a little chalk here. All right. Bill, you want to give me a towel over there? Come on. Boy. Yeah, you.
Hey. Hey.
Ah, you pussycat. All right, let's get it.
You want a hand, Dick?
No, Bill, stand back. You may hurt yourself. Get this over here.
Dick, I think I'm just going to stick around with my old routine, you know, but thanks a lot. I'm going to go.
I'll call you. Whew. Boy, I think I've had it for the day, guys. Yeah. You guys going to be around tomorrow or what? Well, I'm going to be here tomorrow. You know, you gotta do this stuff every day or it's not gonna do you a bit of good. Believe me, I know what I'm talking about. I'll see you guys later.
This is the Friday edition with your correspondent, Melanie Chartoff.
Good evening, I'm Melanie Chartoff, and these are tonight's top stories. President Carter this week appealed to Cuban President Fidel Castro to allow for a more humane exodus of refugees to the United States. Castro responded by saying those fleeing were disease-ridden prostitutes and convicts who don't deserve better treatment. Meanwhile, in Key West, Florida, American servicemen waited eagerly to meet the new arrivals. Here, Marine Sergeant Ralph Walker is seen carrying away an unidentified Cuban woman he purchased for $1.50. Said Walker, "She's no Bo Derek, but at these prices, how can you go wrong?" Former President Spiro Agnew, who resigned his office in disgrace after pleading no contest to income tax evasion, said Thursday that he is considering running for public office again and acknowledged that he has been having discussions with Republican frontrunner Ronald Reagan. Reagan, when asked if Agnew might be his running mate, said he was considering several other likely candidates as well, including Richard Speck, Charles Manson, and alleged son of Sam Killer, David Berkowitz. In Illinois this week, frantic last-minute lobbying is taking place to gain the additional 2 votes needed to ratify the Equal Rights Amendment in that state. Resisting House members said they would agree to vote for ERA if the female campaigners would promise to look pretty, laugh at their jokes, and have sex with them in their cars. And in a related story, presidential hopeful Ronald Reagan, an opponent of equal rights amendments, punished his wife Nancy for expressing an opinion at a political luncheon by forcing her to stand in a corner during his entire campaign swing through Michigan. Sean Weatherly, Miss South Carolina, became the new Miss USA Thursday and will go to Seoul, Korea in July for the Miss Universe pageant. While everything is coming up roses now for the lovely blue-eyed blonde whose measurements are 35, 25, 36, she will one day drop dead, be tossed into a box, and her toothless, wrinkled corpse will become the food for maggots. And we'll be back after this message.
This is not Juan Valdez. This is his cousin, Luis. Like his cousin, Luis makes his living picking coffee beans. But Luis does not work for the same growers as Juan. He works for us. Luis's work is more difficult than Juan's. He must work longer hours, under worse conditions, picking the beans by hand and hauling them down the mountain on his back. For this labor, we pay Luis 200 pesos a week, about 20 cents a day. Luis works for wages like these because he is poor and doesn't know any better. Thanks to the exploitation of ignorant peasants like Luis, last year our company grossed over $160 million. That's right, over 160 big ones, with almost no overhead. Luis does not even get paid for this commercial. Our only expense is in bribing government officials who make certain the people remain poor and ignorant. So we will always have lots of Luises to pick our beans for us. If we did not take advantage of people like Luis, then we would have to cut back on quality. And that would not be good for you. So next time you shop for coffee, remember, when you want the richest coffee, buy from the richest coffee company.
Authorities today reported the outbreak of a new swear word, believed to have been started by a 17-year-old boy in a small town in western Nebraska. For more on this story, we take you now to correspondent Mary Edith Burrell.
Melanie, like solar eclipses, new swear words come along once, maybe twice in a lifetime. And it's not often that a new swear word takes hold. Like good wine, the great old swear words for body, waist, and sex organs get better with time. I'm standing here with high school junior Danny Warren, who some people believe is responsible for the new swear word that has jolted this small community, and which many people predict may reach both coasts as early as Monday. Danny, before you came out, I was talking with some of the townspeople, and not one of them would so much as jot the new swear word down on my notepad. So repulsed were they by this filthy new thing to say.
I know. I was just hitchhiking, and a car passed by me real fast, and I shouted something out at them, and I guess a lot of people heard it, and they told a lot of people, and now look.
Well, Danny, can you tell us what this new swear word is?
No, my parents won't let me.
Well, can you tell us how many syllables it has?
No, my parents won't let me.
Can you tell us what letter it starts with?
No, my parents won't let me.
Well, Danny, can you at least whisper it to me?
No, my parents won't let me.
Mr. and Mrs. Warren, I understand that it's a swear word here in Parmenter, Nebraska, but it hasn't caught on yet, if you see what I'm saying, so it isn't officially a swear word yet. What harm could there be in whispering it, huh?
Just well, just once, perhaps. Maybe.
Thank you. That's it? Well, that's nothing but a silly nonsense sound.
I know, but my mouth was full of ice cream at the time.
Well, America, the new swear word is karkfum. How's that used exactly, Danny?
Karkfum this, karkfum that. Yeah. Kiss my...
I'm warning you!
Get him in the...
Mayor Edith Burrell, and as you've all heard, that new swear word is... Finally, ABC Television announced that its new late-night show, Fridays, has been greeted by a barrage of criticism over a previously aired sketch entitled Diner of the Living Dead. The piece, which humorously depicted acts of cannibalism, including the eating of actual human limbs at an all-night diner, was cited as the worst display of bad taste ever aired on television. In a conciliatory gesture and without any network pressure, the producers of Fridays have voluntarily withdrawn their most offensive sketch from tonight's program. The sketch was entitled Gladys and the Pips of the Living Dead. And the leg-eating scene, pictured here, was the funniest thing in it anyway, so you haven't missed much. For the Friday edition, I'm Melanie Chartoff. Please have a pleasant weekend.
This has been the Friday edition with your correspondent, Melanie Chartoff.
And now, here is Bosquez!
Call you.
Channel 71 welcomes you once again to Matsoi, a self-defense program designed to save your life in an emergency. Here now is your host, Rabbi Emanuel Kimmelman.
Hello, and welcome to Matsoi. What can you do to protect yourselves and your loved ones from sudden attack? Our streets are dangerous. How may we go about our daily tasks in peace, especially at night? Matsoi holds the answer. Through this rigid program of concentration and self-will, you too can prepare yourself to meet almost any life-threatening situation. Come with me now as Rabbi Isaiah Feinberg helps to illustrate the basic principles of Matsoi. Welcome, Rabbi Feinberg.
Welcome.
You appear to be in good health.
Thank you. I feel well.
To illustrate the basic technique, Rabbi Feinberg will remove a single sheet of matzah from which we derive the name of our self-defense technique, Matsoi. Rabbi?
Certainly. Live and be well.
Now, if Rabbi Feinberg will hold the board firmly in his hands thusly, I will position myself at arm's length and prepare to smash through the board in a single blow.
Live and be well.
To facilitate this, it is good to produce a sound as we strike. Inhale fully, hold the breath, and then release it suddenly, combining the sharp thrust with the sound oi. Thusly.
Oi!
Now, try that at home. Pick up several sheets. Have your partner hold them firmly. Position yourself accordingly. And strike.
Play!
In actual combat, we will develop a variety of attack modes. In Matsoi, we call this defense position the secondary stance. We prepare psychologically, coil ourselves, and spring forth thusly.
Live and be well.
Oi! And now, in the time remaining, we come to that portion of the program that we call the four questions. Each week, we take questions from our viewers and respond to four pre-selected letters. Rabbi?
Our first letter comes from a lathe worker in Cleveland who asks, "We just put carpet down in our home. Should we work outdoors?" There are no references to carpeting in the sacred books. This is a private decision for each adult.
Our final three questions all come from a husband and wife in Levittown, New York, who ask, What is the relevance of matzoy anyway? What is its religious significance? And how may be it utilized in actual real-life situations? The answers to which we now show you in the following illustration. Let us imagine, if you will, that Rabbi Feinberg is walking home from shul and is set upon by a low-life vermin hoodlum. Good evening. It is my firm intention to remove your wallet. Now.
My wallet? Better I should drop dead, you animal bastard.
Believe me, I am prepared to use force to obtain it.
Fair! Puh. I spit where your children breathe!
For the last time, give me your wallet, or for sure you will be sorry.
Better my daughter should lie with an Arab before you'll get one penny from me, you heathen scum!
This is your decision? Very well.
Until next time, this is Rabbi Feinberg and Rabbi Kimmelman wishing you health, security, and prosperity. Rabbi?
Certainly.
Live and be well.
Okay, once again, here is Boz Gag.
George's got his gun.
finally alone. My shirt is torn as usual, but this time I notice a cut over my left eyebrow. Again, I toss it up as part of the price I pay. Being the last male heterosexual in San Francisco. Couldn't get a date. Now I'm in demand. Something that's become increasingly unbearable since Jeff and Kent, the other two male heterosexuals, left San Francisco. Jeff's become a Jesuit priest, and Kent is currently writing a book on how to gain the upper hand in a relationship.
Go away. Please, go away! Go away!
It's the FSC Flower Man from Mr. Paul Thompson.
How do I know it's the Flower Man?
Our toll-free number is 800-555-2343.
Okay, I thought it was somebody else.
Say, aren't you the Paul Thompson, the last male heterosexual left in San Francisco?
Yeah.
Gee, you must have it made in the shade.
Believe me, it's no picnic.
Wish I was straight.
Yeah, well. Too bad. Yeah, thanks a lot. Dear Paul, thanks for being who you are, the San Francisco Ladies Garment Union.
What's going on here? This is becoming a nightmare. I used to thrive on being a heterosexual. What the hell? Maybe it's just a phase.
Paul, open up. It's Tom.
It's Tom, my gay friend. Some days I go undercover gay with Tom just so I can get some fresh air. Of course, I have to hold his hand in public, but it's worth it.
All right, just a second, Tom. All right, okay, listen, don't start any trouble. Leave quietly or I'm gonna have to call the police.
Do you really think the police will sympathize with the problems of a male heterosexual? Get serious.
Then what do you want?
I just want to look at you. To talk with you. To know what it's like to be with a straight man.
Is that all?
Uh-huh.
Paul.
Hey, Paul.
Paul. Come sit. Come on. Sit. It's all right. There.
Now, Tom, what do you think of women, huh?
I like them.
Oh.
I think a woman's place is in the home.
Uh-huh. And who would you like to be our next president?
Definitely Ronald Reagan. If he was in, we wouldn't have the problems we're having right now.
I see. And what's your favorite television show?
Without a doubt, The Misadventures of Sheriff Lobo. I love that show.
I'm sorry for having barged in on you like this.
Wait a second, where are you going? Don't you want to,
I wouldn't care if you were the last straight man on Earth. I don't find you that interesting.
Hey, what's he like?
Well, girls, he's not that interesting.
What?
He's not that attractive.
Oh, you're kidding.
He's not that sensitive.
Forget it.
Wouldn't you know it? Come on, girls. Let's all move to Minneapolis, where there are lots of straight men.
Good. Let them go. Who needs them? You know, I think I'll call Mary. She's really a nice girl. A little heavy, but I once made her laugh.
Hello, this is Mary. I am not here at the moment, for I am moving to Minneapolis. My number in Minneapolis is area code 612-555-6758.
Paul!
Paul!
You're Paul!
Hey, Paul!
Hope you did. We want to give our special thanks to our special guest star, Boss Skaggs. Be sure to join us next week, won't you?